shorten the ropes on you on a sheep shank. Like that. Three
boy
in there.
Give Mr. Needy my compliments and tell him there's still no sign of the ship's boat.
Aye, Mr. Blake.
Captain Bane's been gone 3 hours now. What do you reckon, Mr. Blake? Trouble?
Any trouble you're likely to get from me.
Wouldn't have minded a run ashore.
No more than the rest of us. Get that rope coiled. And you, I don't want them feathers all over this deck.
What is it, Mr. Blake?
Him of all people.
Captain O'Neill, sir.
Oh, and about damn time, too.
Where the hell have you been?
Well, in a manner of speaking, you can say I've been looking after your family's
interests. Get on with it, will you? Are we ready to sail yet?
Aye, when you and your visitor have finished talking, sir.
Visitor? What visitor?
I know you. You're Blake, Matthew Blake. We sailed together.
That's right, Sir Daniel. When you were master of the Orlando.
Well, it's a tidy few years ago. Is Captain O'Needham aboard?
He's below.
Could you get that crate aboard and my baggage? Crate's heavy. I'd rather you didn't drop it, Mr. Blake.
You there! Get a couple of fathoms of chain, and you, rig up a block of tackle on that boom.
So, he's nobility, then?
He is now.
Aye. Changes a man, does a title.
Well, some things never change.
Holds your favor, does he?
Will you mind your own business?
Wonder what he's got in that crate.
Bullion? How much?
£100,000 with.
Well, there's no room in the hold, sir. Those bales of wool are screwed in so tight a rat couldn't breathe down
there. There's only one crate, James. You keep it here in the saloon. You've plenty of room.
No, not so fast, Daniel. Why not on a freighter ship, eh?
Well, there's not one due in Cape Town for at least 6 weeks. Now, it's a long time to sit guarding that amount of gold.
Well, not if it's safely in a vault. Let's see the other half of this, eh?
I thought you might want to know more.
I want to know a damn sight more. You know, I don't like the smell of this. Is that your crate now?
Yes, I asked Mr. Blake to take care of it.
Captain Baines, I don't want that crate aboard until I say so.
And I suggest you conclude this business quickly, sir. Within the hour, we'll have the usual offshore wind, and I'd like to be underway.
I know.
Well, you were the one who wanted a fast passage, sir, not me.
Right, Daniel. Cards on the table. All of them.
Very well, James. As you know, I've had interest in South Africa for some time, mostly in gold mining. Now, Tom McCauley warned me there was trouble brewing out here 2 years ago, and he was right.
The Boers, eh?
Yes. South Africa's a powder keg. It's not the place to have a lot of capital tied up in.
So, you sold out, eh?
Yes.
Why gold? Why not a banker's draft made payable in Liverpool, eh?
Come now, James. Why show something in company books when you don't have to?
How about insurance?
Well, my instructions went off to Lloyd's and the steamship Leander out of Durban last week. Well, that was after I heard that you were due to call here in the Christian Radic.
So you named my ship, eh?
Aye.
Took quite a gamble that I'd agree, didn't you?
Well, there's no reason for you not to.
Oh, well, now that you've committed yourself so far, I hope we don't fall out over freight charges.
Well, they're fairly standard. Now, a Fraser steamer would have
damn what a Fraser steamer would charge you. Here I make my charges, and that's 2% of the value, right?
Two? That's £2,000, man.
Well, it's a very risky business, is bullion, you know.
Well, damn it, man, I'm covering the risk myself.
I'm only thinking of the ship. If news of this was to leak out, I could have a mutiny on board before you could say Jack Robinson.
1%, now that's a fair price.
Baines!
All right. I'm nailed to the deck and we both know it.
£2,000 it is then, eh? And seeing as I'm such a generous man, I'll throw in your passage for nothing.
Captain, can't we tie off? Could be hanging on this damn thing all day.
You'll hang on until I know whether it's coming aboard or not.
It's coming aboard.
You heard the order, lads. Heave!
Come on, get aboard!
Heave!
By the time we get this stowed and underway, we'll be facing a foul tide and a foul wind.
And a foul-tempered captain, no doubt, eh? Still, I don't mind losing a day if I can pick up an extra £2,000.
Is that what you charged him?
Cut off with your backs, Larry!
I hold down the hands, Flake? Well, I thought you might like to run up the skull and crossbones.
Man that capstan!
I serve me time in the black ball line.
Timmy way, hey, hey, hurrah!
Oh, in the black ball line, I serve me time.
Hurrah for the black ball line!
Checkmate!
The black ball ships, they are good and true.
Timmy way, hey, hey, hurrah!
I want 40 of the men laid off straight away, Dunwoody.
The 40? Well, surely with the other work we have on hand, that won't be necessary.
We were due to start work on Simmons's ship the first of the month. I'll not pay for idle hands.
Well, sir, I know it came as something of a shock, Mr. Simmons cancelling, but
40, I said. Kindly arrange it with the yard foreman now, if you please.
Yes, well, unfortunately, I have to attend on your mother, Lady Fogarty.
How convenient. Never mind, I'll deal with the matter myself. You might inform my mother yet again that I would prefer a chief clerk of my own rather than your part-time services.
Oh, I'm sure she has your welfare at heart, sir.
You better tell them out there I'm expecting a Mr. Josiah Beaumont.
Oh, he's here, sir. I asked him to wait.
You did what? Mr. Dunwoody, he's a very important man. He's just taken over Harris's bank.
Yes, I was aware of that, sir. Mr. Beaumont, this way, if you please, sir.
Josiah Beaumont, sir. And you will be William Fogarty.
No.
Oh, I was given to understand that your father is Sir Daniel.
Sir Daniel Fogarty, quite correct. I prefer to use the name of Fraser, which I've had all my life. Can I offer you a glass of wine, Mr. Beaumont?
You can, sir. So, my information was not false, simply inadequate. I shall have to take my man to task over that.
How long have you been in Liverpool, sir?
I arrived last night. Early this morning, I looked over the bank premises, addressed the staff, made one or two changes, went through various accounts, then sent my clerk out to arrange a few calls. You're my first appointment of the day, Mr. Fraser. Your health.
And yours, sir. Would you care to sit down?
Thank you. I found it intriguing that one so young could be in charge of both a shipping line and a shipyard.
Surely, Mr. Beaumont, it's ability, not age, that's important. Anyway, within the year, I shall be 21.
Then that would explain why your mother's signature appears on all Fraser checks. You know, I feel you and I might have a good deal in common. Why don't we have lunch together? Get to know one another really well.
When do you suggest?
What's wrong with now?
I thought you had other appointments.
So I have. One of them is with a Mr. Simmons. I believe you know him. But I think he can wait, don't you?
Shall we dine at my club?
Why not?
Do you think it looks right here?
Oh, of course it does.
Oh, 3 months to do that tapestry. I hope James likes it.
By the way, did I tell you that come next week we'll have completed our third ship?
And two more on the stocks.
Yes, you did. Oh, cheer up, Letty. Your business will pick up, you'll see.
If the price of jute bags keeps falling, it won't. The women are barely making a living now.
Well, then some of them will have to go. Letty, what is it?
I've told you.
No, I mean the real problem. Something to do with James?
No. Well, no. I'm feeling a bit under the weather, that's all.
You sure?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I went to see Dr. Porton the other day.
Oh?
Is he reliable?
Why?
Just wondered, that's all.
Letty, you're not...
No.
Oh, I see. And that's the trouble, is it?
Well, I'm not exactly a young maiden, am I? I thought I might be barren.
Oh, don't be ridiculous. You're perfectly healthy. You're probably just over-anxious, that's all. Some women go for years before having a child.
Yeah, that's exactly what Dr. Porton said.
Well, there you are, then. James isn't worried, is he?
James? No. Oh, Elizabeth, I'd rather you didn't
give him a son. That's what he really wants, even though he won't admit it. That'll be done, Woody. I must go. Now, don't worry.
Goodbye, Elizabeth.
Lady Fogarty, I'm not finding my present role an easy one.
With Sir Daniel away, I cannot be in two places at once. You can. Now, what's the trouble?
I'm afraid Mr. Simmons has cancelled his order for the steamship.
What?
Well, Mr. William kept on quoting for extra fittings. Oh, I did advise him to include them in the original estimate, but he wouldn't listen. He said if the price was too high, he wouldn't get the order.
Well, he certainly hasn't got it now.
Quite excellent club, that. I shall have to get someone to propose me.
Yes, it's a useful place, especially for doing business outside office hours. May I take your coat?
No, no. I have to get on to my other appointments. Mr. Simmons, for instance. From what you tell me, I think he's acted rather hastily.
Well, he did make it quite clear that he wanted the lowest possible estimate.
And you naturally assume that he understood some of the extra fittings will be quoted for separately?
Of course.
Well, knowing the craftsmanship that goes into a Fraser vessel, the bank won't hesitate to advance Mr. Simmons what he needs. Value for money. On the other hand, if he decides to go elsewhere...
Yes?
Well, let's just say we might not be so amenable. Of course, had you waited until the ship was near completion before informing him, I doubt that he'd have been in a position to argue.
I see. Yes, I take your point, sir.
There is always the right moment for everything.
William, I would like a word with you.
Mother, we were discussing business.
I was just going anyway. Delighted to meet you, Lady Fogarty.
William, perhaps you would be so kind as to introduce us.
Of course. Mother, may I present Mr. Beaumont?
Josiah Beaumont, your servant, ma'am.
Ah, yes. You're the man who forced poor Mr. Harris out of his bank.
Hardly forced, Lady Fogarty. Mr. Harris was as anxious to sell as we were to buy. I'd hate you to think badly of me.
Oh, I doubt I shall think of you at all, Mr. Beaumont.
Lady Fogarty, Mr. Fraser.
Good afternoon, Mr. Beaumont. You deliberately insulted him.
Yes.
That man can be of tremendous value to this company. His father controls one of the largest merchant banks in London and another in Manchester.
And now one here in Liverpool. I know all about the Beaumonts, thank you, both junior and senior. I've heard all I need to know from Mr. Harris.
A man who couldn't keep control of his own bank.
Are you trying to emulate him?
I beg your pardon.
And well you might, by the time I've had my say.
If you're going to criticise my running of phrases,
yet again... That is exactly what I intend doing.
It was expressly understood that I be given a free hand to put my ideas into practice.
With the proviso that they worked. Your father and I still own 30% of this company, and I don't intend to see that frittered away.
You have my word that as soon as I'm 21, I shall be happy to buy you out.
With what? If you lose any more orders, the company won't be worth a penny.
I see. Dunwoody's telling tales again.
This is the second order that's been cancelled. Simmons has been a client of Fraser's for years. Four ships we've built for that man.
And we shall build a fifth one for him.
Not according to Dunwoody. Do you deny you had a letter of cancellation?
No, but within a few days he will change his mind. I shall build his ship, and for a higher profit per ton than you or grandfather ever achieved.
I hope you're right.
I shall be.
Yes, well, even so, I intend that Mr. Dunwoody spend more of his time on this side of the Mersey.
As you wish.
He could be of help to you, William.
He's your chief clerk, Mama, not mine.
I see. You want help from no one. Will you be dining at home this evening?
No, I'm working late. I'll eat at the club.
Very well.
Of course, it would be more convenient if I had an apartment of my own.
Does it have to be like this, William?
You have what you want from life, Mama. Let me have what I want.
pays out in the end, James. Now, you take South America. There's a couple of Americans I've heard of who are talking about building a canal through the Panama Isthmus.
Well, they'll find it a different kettle of fish than Suez. They'll have to build locks for one thing.
Well, they'll do it. Maybe not now, but one day. And when that day comes, that'll be the end of the nitrate trade. And the end of the sailing ship.
I've got a feeling that any moment now, Baines, Sir Daniel's going to offer to build us a steamer for next to Nowton.
Well, I wouldn't be averse to spreading the cost over your first year's trading. Oh. How's that for a proposition?
Well, I've got an even better one. Now, this cargo of wool I'm carrying, got it at a good price, but with your connections in Australia, why, we could buy at the bottom of the market.
And what would I get out of it?
Well, if you built a ship for us, you'd be sure of getting paid.
A steamship?
Oh, no, no. No, a sailing ship. Steel, four masts, and half the size of this again.
No, thank you, James. There's no future in it. Now, I'll find a better way of paying back those freight charges. Good night to you.
Oh, good night, Doc.
That'd be the end of rounding the horn, wouldn't it, sir?
What would?
A canal through Central America. When that happens, no more real men. Just milksops, canal sailors. Yes, Mr. Blake?
About crossing line tomorrow, sir. Permission for King Neptune and his queen to come aboard.
How many to initiate?
Well, there's young Tim and the Swede. The others are keeping quiet, but I reckon there's two more.
All right, lay it on, Mr. Blake.
Aye, aye, sir.
I wager that takes you back a few years, sir.
Aye. Something you don't forget in a hurry, eh?
Sailors,
rouse them out, lads! Don't let them get away! King Neptune wants to meet his subjects! Bring him to me, lads! Bring him to me! Take their voices!
What do you think of the boy, my dear? Does he tickle your fancy? Hey!
What? No, you can't have the parson's nose.
If you want that one, my dear, you better fetch him yourself. And now, my lad, you'll be wondering just when I'd have cut off. I shouldn't wonder, eh? Well, accidents do happen. Ask soft Charlie over there. Right, get him in the chair, boy. Come on. Sit down, lad.
If they're wise, they won't put up much of a fight. I was on a voyage once with a couple of lads' feet with tar. You know, they ended up having to cut his boots off. My belly tells me it's time for food, sir.
They're almost done.
Mr. Blake.
Aye, sir.
Make sure that they clean up afterwards.
No worries, sir, I will.
You famine!
Samuel, it's good to see you. Why would you change this?
It's the sideburns, Mother.
Of course. They make you look so grown up.
Well, perhaps that's because I am.
Jarvis, you can come back for Mr. Samuel's luggage later. First of all, you must see the new house. All the money we've spent on it, you'd never believe it. And then after luncheon, you must see the store.
Oh, will Father be there?
No, I'm sorry, my dear. He's touring the continent on business. He is determined that that store will sell the very best that Europe can offer. He's counting on you, Samuel.
No, Mother,
We're both counting on you. After all, one of these days, that store will be yours. The ideas he wants to discuss with you.
Oh, Mother, please don't go building up your hopes. Now that I'm of age...
Samuel, right from the moment you were born, the one thing he's always wanted is the two of you working together, side by side. Don't disappoint him.
Well, I don't want to.
He's changed a lot. And now that you're grown up, he'll listen to you, treat you as an equal. Why, he's even insisted that you have your very own office right next to his. And this evening, you're to be my escort to Mr. Beaumont's sherry party. Samuel.
Hello, Aunt Elizabeth. Oh.
Hello, Samuel.
William, I hope I don't have to call you Lady Fogarty.
Oh, certainly not, Samuel. And you must come round and tell me all of your adventures in America.
And I'm sure he'll tell you a lot more than he's told me.
Excuse me.
Have you been here long?
No. And I don't intend staying long either.
Yeah, I hear they've put you in charge of Fraser's.
Yes. It's quite a responsibility.
Oh, well, you always were good at figures. Thank you. This is a bit of a rum-do, isn't it?
Well, old Harris would never have done it, if that's what you mean. Oh. But I think Beaumont's got some very good ideas, and he's willing to take risks. Can you imagine anyone here agreeing to take a gamble? Solid, prosperous businessmen, all of them, without so much as a penny worth of adventure between them.
Ah, except for you and I, that is.
In 5 years, I intend to be richer than any one of these men.
That's your goal, is it, William?
Yes.
How's Charlotte?
Oh, quite well, I think.
You and she still...
Come on, I'll introduce you to Mr. Beaumont.
America's changed, Samuel, so much, Elizabeth.
They're growing up, Sarah. It's time to let go.
Let go? But Samuel is bound to Robert and I by love and duty. After all, that was the way he was brought up. Honour thy father and thy mother, the good book says.
And to thine own self be true. Strange, isn't it, how we seem to understand other people's children more than we do our own.
That may be true for you, Elizabeth. But then, after all, William always was a willful boy.
Oh, thank you very much. This really is very good, sir.
Will you excuse me, Sarah?
Mm-hmm.
Ah, Mr. Simmons. I understand you've reconsidered your decision.
Let us say, Lady Fogarty, the decision was made for me.
In what way?
Spending so much of your time the other side of the Mersey, it's difficult for you to keep in touch. The pity is you ever left Fraser's.
I'm well aware that my son lacks experience, Mr. Simmons, but give him time.
Oh, he's learning fast, Lady Fogarty.
I think perhaps you had better explain yourself.
Your son and Mr. Beaumont seem to be on very good terms.
Well?
And I am dependent on Beaumont to finance this new ship of mine. If I go to another yard, he'll withdraw his support. But I'll not be bitten twice. This is the last ship that Fraser's will build for me.
No, no, I can assure you that I'm not a man who gives praise lightly. Far from it. Believe me, Mrs. Anedon, your husband's department store equals any in London.
Do you hear that, Samuel?
Yes, Mother.
And as soon as your husband returns, I shall insist you both dine with me.
I'm sure Robert will be delighted to meet you.
Capital. And if you could persuade your charming son to join us, so much the better.
William, will you be so good as to summon the carriage and take me home?
Mama, we've only...
Something wrong, Lady Fogarty.
Elizabeth, you look quite flushed.
I find the atmosphere oppressive.
Oh, dear, I hope you haven't caught a chill.
So do I. For I'm dining with the Harrises tomorrow night. Dear Mr. Harris, such an upright man. Are you not coming, Sarah?
I think perhaps we should, Mother.
Come along, William.
Thank you very much, Mr. Beaumont.
Thank you, Mr. Beaumont, and good night.
Good night.
I'm sorry. Thank you for a very pleasant evening, Mr. Beaumont.
Ah,
Mrs. Halifax. So nice to see you.
Mr. Halifax.
And having said that, she swept out. And within 5 minutes, all the other guests had left as well.
Poor Mr. Beaumont.
Oh, I doubt you'd say that if you'd met him, Aunt Letty.
Oh, I feel sorry for anyone who gets on the wrong side of your Aunt Elizabeth. Yeah. Did you have a chance to talk to William?
Yes, yes, he seems to have changed a lot. Are he and Charlotte still seeing one another?
Yes, occasionally. Still, I know she'd like to see you, Samuel. You must come to tea one day, if you can get away from the store.
Yes, I'm afraid that once Father gets back, that store looks like being my prison, unless I do something about it.
Oh, dear Samuel, you're not still hankering after the sea, are you?
It's what I've always wanted, Aunt Letty. It's not just the ships. I want to travel. I want to see the rest of the world.
Oh, perhaps your father will agree. You won't know till you ask him, will you?
No. Robert and Eden and son. That's the future they've planned out for me. I'll not be able to make a decision of my own until my father's in the grave. By then, I'll be so old, I won't want to change anything.
I thought your mother would never go.
Yes, so did I.
I walked around the yard 3 times, and whenever I came back, her carriage was still outside.
Charlotte, I think when my father returns, they'll agree to me having a place of my own.
William, I've been away for a whole month, and all you can talk about is getting a place of your own. Well, you haven't yet said you miss me.
But of course I did. What I meant was that if I had an apartment of my own, then when we met, it would be completely private.
Oh, but you're in the office all day.
And some evenings, but not all.
Well, I suppose it would be all right to call on you just for a little while. If we were going somewhere, on our way to a concert or the theatre like tonight.
Yes, about tonight.
Oh, no, you bought the ticket, you wrote and told me.
Listen, this man's in Liverpool for one day only. Tonight's the only time I can get to see him.
And because it's business, it's more important, I suppose.
Well, we'll go another night, I promise you.
Oh, perhaps it's just as well you don't have a place of your own, William. Why, then I really would have been disappointed.
You see, the point is, Aunt Letty, unless I go now, I'll never get away. And the trouble is, I know it's going to hurt Father dreadfully.
Look, Samuel, I'm really flattered that you should confide in me.
Oh, I'm sorry,
but I'm going to give you some advice. Now, your father's due home soon, and like as not, having come to this point, you'll tackle him before he's got his coat on. Well, don't. Give him time to settle down. Wait a few days, a week even, and then introduce the subject gradually.
Is that how you do it with Uncle James?
Don't be so cheeky.
To the minute. I admire punctuality, William. I trust I may call you, William.
Of course. Business, you said. I assume you're off somewhere afterwards.
We're both off somewhere. I thought you might care to show me the delights of Liverpool. A music hall, perhaps, and then supper. I had thought of the theatre, but then you're not really dressed, are you? Never mind. Come. I have it on good information that Sir Daniel is in South Africa. Has one or two mining interests there, I believe.
Yes, yes, he does.
Good. I'd like to talk to you about that.
Hey, son. Mind you don't fall in that.
Thank you, son.
You look remarkably pleased with yourself, Ben.
Eh? Well, I was just thinking, sir. Another 24 hours and we'll be home. Do you know we've travelled over 11,000 miles and haven't burnt one bucket full of coal? And how's that, Sir Daniel?
And how's that, Sir Daniel?
Mine, I think, full hours. If we'd been becalmed, Captain Baines, I'll wager you'd have wished you were on a steamship.
Yes, Mr. Blake.
Fire, sir. Fire it old.
Who else knows?
Only Barnabas. He had a good sense to tell me on the quiet.
Give him a break.
Aye, aye, sir.
Come on.
No sense in drawing attention before we need to. You stay here.
It comes and goes, sir. It's died down a bit now.
Always from the same place?
No, sir. Sometimes a bit abaft.
What do you think, sir? Spontaneous combustion?
Let's get below where we can talk, huh?
I see. You stay here and keep an eye on it. Anybody else sees it, tell them it's steam from the wall.
I only wish it were.
Now, this was the hottest part. Somewhere in this area.
If it's above the waterline, maybe we can get at it.
Well, then bales are screwed in tight. It's going to be a hell of a job getting them out.
If the air gets at it, the ship could go up like tinder. That's something I don't want to chance unless I have to.
Well, there's no way into that hole without lifting the hatches.
You can't take the hatchboards off.
Not all, just a few. We get them off quick, locate the center of the fire, get the hoses in.
And ruin every damn bale of wool that I've got.
Well, James, that's not what I'm worried about. My crate is worth more than this ship and your cargo put together.
Your crate, and sure.
What do you mean?
All right, lads, we have got a fire aboard. No need to panic. We'll soon have it under control. Now, I want you to follow Captain Baines's word to the letter, or you'll have me to answer to. Right, now we're going to flood the hold. You four on the bilge pumps. You four
on
the deck tops. The rest of you form a bucket, James.
I want that hatch and these decks swimming with water.
Well then, let's get these buckets.
Carpenter! Give me a belly brace, a bandsaw, and two bumps. Ten! Ten!
Over here, Mr. Blake, when I give the order.
I want some of these hatch balls off, but slowly. Smoke, you see any flames? Get them back! Now stand by the pumps! Now!
Faster!
I want a hole in the hatch board about here, big enough to take that pipe.
Right, sir. The hose covered up to the bilge pump.
Right, sir.
Right, Carpenter. When you finish that, I want another hole. Oh, there. Come on, lad, get it going. Faster!
Come on! Come on! He's coming to it! Where the devil did she come from?
Hooray! Come on, what will you stop for? Put your backs into it! Baines, we do not require help. Yet?
Well, it looks like you're getting it, though. Come on now, come on, come on, keep going.
Come on!
Keep that puppy there! Hop away! Come on,
get that line off my ship!
Come on,
come on, come on. Come
on. Oh, James, they can help!
They can also collect salvage.
Well, whatever, the insurers will pay that!
Oh, come on, let's get back to
work. Keep going!
What have you done before?
Mr. O'Needham, the smoke's abating.
So it is. Come on, lads. You're winning.
What did I tell you, Daniel?
Fire's under control. Hands are standing by.
Yeah. I'll warrant your throat's as dry as mine, eh?
It is. You wanted to see me, sir?
Ah, yes, Mr. Blake. For the lads, with my compliment.
Thank you, sir. Oh, I'm glad we managed to save your valuable cargo, Sir Daniel. Whatever it is.
Now, tell me, James, is your cargo insured?
No.
And the ship?
half insured, same as the Neptune and the Trident.
Well, that's a lot of risk to carry.
Well, other owners do the same.
It's only an economy until you lose a ship or a cargo.
Hasn't happened yet. We should be seeing Anglesey off our starboard beam soon.
Back on the voyage?
Yes, sir.
One you never forget.
No, sir.
Better keep in touch with Captain Baines. He might find another berth for you.
I don't think I'll be going to sea again, sir.
Why? Because you took a dip in the ocean. He'll be back. Mr. Blake.
Give the lad a trick at the wheel, eh?
Aye, Captain.
James, I'd like a word. Below. You too, Captain Baines.
What's the course, Mr. Blake?
Aye, sir.
Have you counted them, Sir Daniel?
I don't need to. The chest was made to fit the bars. There's 5 layers, 12 bars to a layer. There's 3 missing.
1,500 pounds a bar.
Could they have been taken before you came aboard?
Well, look at the splinters. Look at the marks. It's been opened on this ship.
One thing I can't abide is thieving. Especially on board one of my ships.
Well, while we were busy with the fire, anybody could have come down here, sir.
Well, there's one consolation. Those 3 bars are still on board this ship.
Well, then let's put into the nearest anchorage and search the ship.
If we're not careful, those sailors will finish up our plane past the slipper.
Not if I get Blake to line them up on deck first.
Blake?
Eh?
Oh, no, James. He and I sail together.
Right, come along now. I want to see daylight between each man. Keep your arms folded in front of you, just where I can see them.
What's all this about?
Thieving, that's what. Property of Sir Daniel Fogarty. And if that sticky-fingered scab could step forward right now, it would save us all a lot of time.
Hello.
Found something?
No.
Come along now. You're only making it worse for yourselves. We'll find that scab, and when we do, he'll wish he'd never been born.
I'll not have thieving aboard my ship. Own up now, or you'll feel a rope across your back.
Begging your pardon, sir. That ain't allowed. Not anymore, it ain't. And that's the law.
Aboard my ship, I'm the law.
Daniel.
Whose bunk is this?
When it comes to thieving, I don't need a fucks a lawyer to tell me what I can or cannot do. Get back in line.
Right then. Now I'm going to give you one last chance.
It was me.
You?
Baines. Bring him below.
Aye, aye, sir.
Come on, lad.
Where did you find them?
Behind his bunk.
Did you steal these? Well, you've a lesson to learn. Now you can either take your punishment from me, Get it over and done with. Or you can be handed over to the law when we get to shore. Which is it to be?
Answer, Mr. Uneaton boy.
Well, why, Tim? Why did you do it?
Well, why should you have all that gold?
Because he worked for it, that's why! Get his shirt off, Mr. Blake!
Aye, aye, sir.
No! Sir, lots of people work hard, only they end up with nothing.
Sir!
Yes, what is it?
Begging your pardon, sir. I'd like to say a word on the lad's behalf, sir.
Very well.
Well, it was me as told him there might be gold in that crate, sir.
Did you tell him to steal it?
No, no, of course not, sir. But only I got him this berth, you see, sir, and... well, I feel kind of responsible.
So you knew him before, did you?
Aye. His father died of the consumption last Christmas, sir, and his dad and me was mates.
Well, let the boy go, James. He's had a hard start to life.
Oh, plenty of that harder start than him in life. You've got some growing up to do. Barnabas.
Sir.
Trident sails for Valparaiso. If I put this lad in your keeping, will you both sign?
Aye, gladly, sir.
And you?
Yes, sir.
Well, then it's your responsibility.
Thank you, sir. He'll not go astray again, sir, I promise you. Now, you thank Mr. Uneaton, lad.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, come on, before he changes his mind. Up quick, come on.
Round of the horn doesn't make a man of him. Nothing will.
You know, it's funny my finding you're bullying like that, Sir Daniel. Well, I reckon it evens up the score a bit.
Oh? I don't follow you.
Indian Ocean, 61. I was out in the bowsprit when I slipped and went overboard. There were sharks about. I was 20 yards astern when you dived in. By the time you got me into the longboat, those brutes were just a few feet behind us.
Well, damn me, I'd quite forgotten about that.
Yeah, I thought you might have. But I've got a long memory, Sir Daniel.
What was that for? Another favor?
Well, you reckon it's a favor at the time. Hong Kong, the same voyage. I got sweet on a Chinese girl, Wu Chung. I was going to marry her, remember? And you had me shipped out double quick. You said it would never work out. Well, what you didn't know was that her father was a rich silk merchant. And she was his only child. So you see, Sir Daniel, but for your good intentions, I'd be a rich man now. Well, maybe as rich as you.
Well, there's not much I can say to that, is there?
Not much. Of course, I'd have to give him up the sea, and by now I'd be as fat as a pig with a dozen mouths to feed, so... Well, I'm not complaining, really.
Then why did you...
Because I promised you that at the time. And I always keep my promises, Sir Daniel.
Well, we were just talking over old times.
Sir Daniel?
A pilot's just come aboard. And that ship that you sent your insurance instructions to Lloyd's on, what was it called?
The Leander.
Thought so. Went down off the Scillies last week.
So that bullion...
That bullion has travelled halfway across the world without being insured.
Well, in that case, I'm very glad you threw that tow rope overboard.
Aye. They'd have claimed a pretty penny in salvage off you.
On the other hand, I've saved myself nearly £1,000 in premiums.
So you have. You could look on it that I'd transported you and your bullion for nothing.
No, James, we couldn't look on it that way at all. Now, what are you after?
Well, I couldn't help but notice, but Fraser's are laying down another couple of ships.
And?
Well, you'll be wanting steel plates from Swansea, eh? I could quote you very fair rates.
And so could the Fraser line.
Oh, come on, Daniel. One favor deserves another.
James, I think I've had enough favors returned for one day. Huh? Oh, very well. The contract's yours.
Oh, good. We'll be docking at noon. Come round to tea. We'll talk over the details then, eh?
Oh, does suit you. It looks beautiful on you, milady.
I think it would look better on you.
Oh, no, no, Daniel bought it for you. This is my favourite.
Oh, did you look at that?
Isn't the needlework exquisite?
Oh, yes.
Oh, James, let's not haggle. We'll split the difference.
Well, it's a lot less than I'd hoped for.
And it's a lot more than I wanted to pay.
Now, don't let your tea get cold.
Come on, two business can wait.
Oh, James, wherever are you going to hang this?
Oh, I know just the place for that. Right over here. Where the heck did that come from?
Don't you like it?
Well, it's, well, it's different, yes.
Right. We'll not wait for Charlotte.
You know that that girl gallivants around too much, huh? Right, sit down, everybody. Right, this looks nice. Still, there's one consolation, Letty. Once Charlotte's off our hands, we'll do some gallivanting around ourselves, eh? Just the two of us. Alone.